Our scripture this morning comes from the book of Acts, the 9th chapter, verses 15 through 20. I'd ask that you stand as we read the holy word of God. Again, that is Acts, the 9th chapter, verses 15 through 20. And it reads thusly. But the Lord said unto him, Go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me, to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. For I will show him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake. And Ananias went his way and entered into the house and put his hands on him, said, Brother Saul, the Lord, even Jesus that appeared unto thee in the way as thou camest, hath sent me, that thou mightest receive thy sight and be filled with the Holy Ghost.
Yes, sir.
And immediately there fell from his eyes as it has been scales, and he received sight forthwith, and arose and was baptized. And when he had received meat, he was strengthened. Then was Saul certain days with the disciples which were at Damascus. And straightway he preached Christ in the synagogues, that he is the Son of God.
Amen.
This is the mighty word of God for the people of God.
Bless us, Lord.
We shall, again, would you stand and let us sing our pastor's favorite song, Blessed Assurance. Blessed Assurance.
Good morning, Mount Zion. It's good to be here this morning on the first cold Sunday of the year. And I guess that's what has affected our attendance. But nonetheless, the Bible, as our pastor have said, when two or three is gathered in his name, we should rejoice and give praise.
Amen.
To our pastor who struggles. Yes, I do. I understand that our pastor struggles just like everybody else who struggle and who is blessed. You can be both struggle and you can be blessed with us and with God and with life. I give honor to this morning. I acknowledge the Lord Jesus Christ as the head of my life. And I say good morning to this great congregation. You don't need a lot of people to get things done. You learn that very early in life. When sometimes there's a crowd that's too many people. God has been good to us. To the official board of this church and to our presiding officer, thank you so much and good morning, Deacon.
Good morning.
So it is good to be here. If you were with us last time that I preach, I talked about Act in the 9th chapter, and I'll get into that in the morning. Let us pray. Our Father, our God, we have come at this moment, at this hour, to break over the bread of life that you have shown me, O Lord. Remove me, O Lord, for I'm nothing. It is only thee that has power and has glory. I'm duly honored to have the privilege to declare unto the world that Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior, and that God is the Father, and somehow in his infinite wisdom that he has allowed me, just me, O Lord. An imperfect vessel to break thy word unto thou people. Let the congregation say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you. Our discussion is coming from the book of Acts in the 9th chapter. And this is a famous chapter of Acts because it records the conversion of Saul. I didn't say Paul, I said Saul. When you have a conversion from Saul to Paul, that's a conversion. God has the power to even change your name. And you know about this chapter very, you are very familiar with this chapter. I just want to read some verses.
Go right ahead. Yep.
So that you will be even more familiar with it. And I'm reading from the today's English version. And I'm going to pick it up at the 3rd chapter. And Saul was coming near the city of Damascus. Suddenly a light from the sky flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" Then Saul answered the Lord, say, "Who are you, Lord?" I wonder how he knew it was the Lord. And they say, "I am Jesus whom you persecute," the voice said. "But get up and go into the city where you will be told what you must do." What an amazing story. Now, prior to that, you already know that Saul, not Paul, but Saul was on his way to murder and to arrest Christians. That means that he was coming to lock you up. Matter of fact, the Bible recalls that Saul went to the high priest to get warrants for Christians, for those who believed in Christ, because he was prepared to lock you up, to arrest you, to lock you up, to hurt you, and even murder you if he chose to do it. But on the way to Damascus,
go ahead, preacher.
You heard the scripture said he was going down the road in his Cadillac, making his way to the city of Damascus, making his way to St. Louis or Chicago or Detroit. Suddenly a light from the sky flashed around him.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
It scared Saul back then, and if we were going down a dark road, it will scare us today. Last time, my topic was when God shakes you. And I tried to put in context in the first sermon how God shakes you. This morning, my topic is when God shakes you. Same thing. God shakes us in many ways. This deacon right here is a perfect case in point. If you ever heard his testimony, if you look at the car that he was driving in, he shouldn't have been with us this morning.
Amen.
Huh?
Amen.
He was going down the road just like Paul was going down the road. Then he got into a terrific car accident. Instead of God blinding the deacon, God saved him. When God shakes you. And God shakes us in a variety of ways. He calls our spouses home. When God shakes you, he also shakes us. Our children die. He shakes us all the time when we don't have enough money. Can't meet our responsibilities. He shakes us all the time by firing us from good jobs. Some of us don't realize the power of God until something truly happens to us.
Amen.
And I'm going to show you how God shakes you. And then those of us who have the privilege, Pastor,
come on, preach it.
Who have never been shooken before, don't worry about it, because God intends to shake all of us. You're either going to be shaken, or have been shaken, or will be shaken soon. So you, not me, will escape this God to shake us. He shakes us through sickness and disease.
Go ahead, preacher. Yes, sir.
God does whatever he needs to do to get our attention. In the case of Saul, he just stepped into his life without warning. As the Bible records it. But let me tell you, beloved, that God always give us warning. He always give us warning. Whether or not we can see it, whether or not we can understand it, he always gives us warning.
Thank you.
And say how he gives us warning. Well, he gives us warning through the preacher. That's all we do every single Sunday, is declare unto you, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. That's a warning.
Yes.
Our pastor is a prophet too. He declared unto us every single Sunday a warning from the Lord. He declared that the wages of sin is death.
Amen.
The acceptance of Jesus Christ is eternal life. The Bible declares unto us a warning about our behavior. Oh, I'm not talking about your behavior now. I'm talking about your behavior when you're not in church. That's the behavior I'm talking about when you relax and around your friends and words slowly comes from your lip that, in the words of Martin King, that is nullification and wrong and sometimes just plain nasty. So God always give warning.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
And God always will shake you. But let me tell you what Gardner Taylor told a young preacher. Got to this church and church elected him. He came in on 60% of the vote. So that was 40% of the church didn't want him to become pastor. And that 40% of the church proceeded, these are Christians, to give him nothing but hell. He had a good family and he preached well and he attended to the sick and communed those who he needed to commune and visit with the young and did everything possible to please the people. But he still got hell. When God shakes you, it goes to show you God has no respect, as I preached last time. He has no respect a person. He don't care whether you are a preacher. He don't care whether you have a nice suit and you're a deacon. He doesn't care what you have gone through. He doesn't care you're small or you look. God has no respect a person. So God shakes preachers. And lately, as pastor have told us, he's been shaking us quite regularly. Huh? He's been shaking us quite regularly. So the young preacher, Gardner Taylor told the young preachers that don't go through all of this hell and get nothing out of it. You got to get something out of it.
Yes.
Don't go through this hell and get nothing out of it. So if God is shaking you, or if God will shake you, don't go through that experience and get nothing out of it.
Amen.
Charles Adam, pastor of Hofford Memorial Church in Detroit, said that he once knew a preacher didn't have a problem in his family, didn't have a problem on his job, didn't have a problem with his neighbor, didn't have a problem with stranger, didn't have a problem at all. And he said that when the preacher got up to preach, his sermon was void and empty. That means you got to go through some stuff to preach this gospel. You got to go through some stuff. You got to be shaken by God to preach this gospel. This gospel will not make you popular. Will not make you rich. It will make you sometime the most hated and despised man there is.
Oh,
that's right. When God shakes you, oh, he shakes all of us. He doesn't care. And he was especially to shake Paul. And I want you to understand that this is a very interesting chapter of the Bible, because at the third verse, the third to the fifth verse, they had Saul on the ground, and he said that the only person who heard that was Saul. The people who were his co-ops, you always have co-ops, who was around him, who was helping Paul kill Christians, who was going to help Paul arrest Christians, they didn't hear that. They just saw that Saul was falling to the ground. So they picked him up and they led him into the town.
Go ahead, please. Come on now.
And then the Bible says that Ananias, that they came to Ananias to go after Paul was led to the house, go and do that. But something happened to Paul before he got there. Paul, according to the scriptures, was blind for 3 days.
Yes.
That great light, blind Paul. And so it goes to show you, beloved, when God shakes you,
when God steps into your path, when God decided to shake you because he wants to get your attention, something will happen to you.
Come on, please.
And I can't tell you up here, is this going to be a positive experience or a negative experience? God decide what type of experience you have to go through. He decide whether or not when you get in a car accident that you walk away with nothing broken, or that you get 10 of your bones broken. I say when God shakes you. I say God decide to shake you. Now I want to stick with the Lord because I'm going to deal with the devil later on this right here. So by the 15th verse, that's why I had him to read it. By the 15th verse, the Lord told Ananias, go because I have chosen him. Now look at that. I have chosen Paul. I have chosen Saul the killer. I have chosen this man who systematically kill and rape and do every manner of things to Christians. You know, some of us, he was doing this to Christians. Saul was doing this to Christians. And we who are here this morning consider ourselves Christians. And I wonder if God put someone on earth to persecute and kill Christians, will he choose us? I wonder, can he tell us by our faith in Christ Jesus, whether or not we have enough fervor, whether or not our lives reflect the teachings and ethics of Jesus to a point that people recognize that we are Christian and we deserve to be prosecuted.
Come on, preacher. Come on.
So what is your point, preacher? That means that some of us are living as though we are not Christian. So the sorrows of our day will just pass us by. Because we are not doing enough in our lives, in our speeches, in our acts for the Lord to be prosecuted in that way.
Praise.
Some of us call ourselves a Christian.
Mm-hmm.
But there seems to be no trait of the personality that you're a Christian.
Praise.
Somebody in the church have a problem? We don't try to help them solve it. We talk about them.
Praise him.
Somebody need some help on the side of the road. The only thing that we do, we don't stop and say, can we be of service? We say, we got to mind our own business and pass right by.
Praise him.
I wonder, do we have enough in our lives to be convicted of the fact of being a Christian?
Come on, Bridget.
So by that verse, it was clean. Go because I have chosen him to serve me. That means I've chosen Saul to serve me, to make my name known to the Gentiles and to the kings and to the people of Israel. That was Paul Tass, who later became Paul. And Ananias said, well, now, come on, God. And now, isn't this the person who was killing Christians?
Come on, preacher. Come on now.
And then, see, this is why you got to pay attention to God. God told Ananias that, go, because I have chosen him. So, which means to say, you don't get a choice on who God chooses for God's work.
Amen.
Only God decides who he chooses for his own work.
Yes.
You don't get that choice. Now there's some preachers who in the pulpit, including myself, who people sit in the audience and say, now why God chose him? There's some people who question why God chose our pastor. Let me straighten that out now. Let me put an end to that. Let me put a period. Let me answer that question with an exclamation mark. God chose our pastor because, according to the Bible, I have chosen him to serve me, to make known my name to the Gentiles and to the kings and to the people of Israel. God does whatever he wants to do.
Amen.
To whomever he chose to do then.
That's right, that's right.
So when God decides to shake you, then you understand that he is God.
Yes.
And see, some of us have bumped our heads and believe that we are God ourselves, and we get to choose and we get to veto God's decision.
All right.
But let me tell you something, beloved. You do not get to choose God's, not veto God's decision. God's decision is God's decision. And that's why the Bible says that don't let a rock cry on your behalf. And now get this, beloved, on the verse 16 of chapter 9. And myself. And I myself will show him that he must suffer for my sake. Oh, come on. I myself must show him that he must suffer for my sake. And you thought you the only one who is going through hell. No. When you accept the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior,
yes.
The Bible says that you shall have trials and tribulations. That means you're going to have to go through some stuff.
Yes.
Our preacher been preaching for 30 years. And he would dare not to tell God, well, I've had 30 years of hell, Lord, give me a break. It doesn't work like that. He's going to be catching and suffering for the sake of the gospel according to our Lord Jesus Christ until God called him home. So if you don't want to be shaken by God, if you don't want to suffer on his behalf, there's the door.
All right.
Because we serve a suffering and redemptive servant.
Yes.
Who is able to save and make you renewed.
Hallelujah.
We don't serve a God who don't know and understand about the suffering that we go through. So when God decides to shake you, when God decides to shake you, he already know how much you can bear. He already know whether or not you're going to survive that accident or not. When God decides to shake you. Now let me tell you, beloved, we got some difficult days ahead, as Martin King would say. Oh, it's not over with yet. Booth, pastor out of Cincinnati, preaching at university, church in Charlotte, just before the election of Barack Obama, talking about the economy. You know what Booth said? Booth, I never will forget this. Booth said that we're going to have to go through some stuff here. We're going to be in this mess for a long time. Now, this guy, now Booth preached that. Now, beloved, Booth preached that sermon in 2005. I was in Charlotte. Now, it's 2011. It's 6 years later, and we're still going through some stuff.
Yes.
We're still going through some stuff. When God decides to shake you, Now, beloved, let me tell you what you shouldn't do. When God decides to shake you, you should not fear. For God has not given us a spirit of fear. He has given us a spirit of triumph, of renewal, of power. God has not given us a spirit of fear. And beloved, let me tell you another thing to do if God decides to shake you. Don't blame God. Don't start trying to hate God.
Praise Him.
You got a lot of folks around here. The reason why they're not in church today is because God took their mother's home. Or God took their father's home. Or God shook them in a way that they couldn't deal with it. And so they decide that they're going to get mad at God.
Yes.
Let me tell you, beloved, you're wasting your time.
Amen.
To try to get mad at God. Because God is God, and He does to whom whatever He chooses to do to you or to me. When God decides to shake you, it is nothing you can do but praise the Lord even more than you praising Him now. When God decides to shake you, tell you God don't have no respect to person. He doesn't care whether or not you've been nice, because niceness won't get you into heaven. Everybody say, well, I'm sweet and I give to others and others give back to me and they like me. And that qualifies me for heaven. No, it does not, according to the word of God. Faith in Christ Jesus is the only qualification to heaven. When God decides to shake you, let me tell you something. When God decides to shake you, don't get angry at your predicament. There are people who are sick right now. They got a disease. They got cancer and they got heart disease and they got diabetes. And they're angry at the Lord. And angry at themselves for their predicament. Now, one of the things about the story of Saul is that what you do not hear is that you do not hear Saul, get this, beloved, you do not hear Saul cursing the darkness, cursing God Almighty for putting him into predicament than what he had. You know what he did? He said that, Lord, you heard his response. Beloved, you heard his response. His response when God knocked him down to the ground, his response was very, very serious. He said, who are you, Lord? In other words, that God had to knock him down to get him to recognize who is Lord and who is his Savior. That's right. See, sometimes that God has to knock even you Christian down to realize that this is a privilege to praise and serve and pray to the Lord.
Yes.
And to be in the house and be a part of this family.
Yes.
Is a privilege.
Yes.
Yes. Everybody thinking that, well, the church needs me because I'm the biggest giver in the church.
Hallelujah.
My pastor understands that the church don't need him. And he don't need that member, because my pastor have 30 years of ministry, and 30 years of ministry will teach you certain things. And one of the things about 30 years of ministry, it will teach you that the biggest giver of the church can be the loudest mouth of the church, or the most silent mouth of the church. And it also teaches you that if you think that the church is depending on you, then you're foolish.
Yes, yes.
You're foolish.
Yes.
This church will go on with or without you. At 8 o'clock, there was 3 or 4 members in this church. And I was going to preach no matter if all of you have left. Because the gospel got to be preached.
Yes.
So now, Now the third thing to do is that don't blame the devil. Don't blame the devil for your circumstances. When God decides to shake you, you cannot particularly blame the devil for your predicament. Because the devil has nothing to do with it. And the devil has nothing to do with God. He has nothing to do. The Bible says that God allows the devil to exist. Allows. Which means to say at any time, God has ultimate power over any evil spirit, the devil, and anybody else, as well as Sister Susie. God has power over everybody and everything. God controls this, not the devil. So you cannot give the devil the credit for shaking you up and setting you right. As I take my seat, let me prove to you that it's not about the devil. If you go back to verse 15, verse 16 said, "And I myself will show him that he must suffer for my sake." And then the verse say in 15, "Go because I have chosen him to serve me." That's right. God has chosen Saul to serve him. God has chosen you and I to serve him. So it's nothing that the devil can do about that. Because when God shake you, you will be shaken. But beloved, just like I warned you that God always give warning.
Go ahead, preacher. Come on now.
Less than a month and a half ago, those of you who were in D.C. felt a little shaking going on. A little shaking going on. I say when God shakes you, he little shaking. And those like myself who were in the house thought it was somebody downstairs drilling. And then when it shook the second time, I immediately recognized it was an earthquake and I was moving out of the door when the Holy Spirit grabbed me back and said, "Reverend, you don't have any clothes on. Go put your pants on." I said, when God shakes you, and that would have been the picture on the Washington Post, Reverend Anthony Evans came running out of the house with no clothes on, just his underclothes. That's right. I could have been embarrassed, but God decided to just warn me. I'm not talking about you.
Come on, preacher.
He decided just to warn me. He decided just to give me another chance because I was upstairs and I got a roof that could have fallen on my head. That was a warning from the Lord. And when the Lord warns you, you got to take note. But beloved, I think that there's something serious at hand and I want to get it in and take my seat. Yes, we have had an earthquake, but we have had a terrible economic times, worse time than even the Great Depression. There have been natural disasters going on like nothing never before. Some of you are 80 years old, have never seen how the earth has shaken, how the hurricanes and how the tornadoes have happened. You have never experienced the amount of killing and death that we are doing here. And I'm going to say something that I don't know that you agree upon, but I don't care because I got to say it because the Lord want me to say it. And that is that God is getting ready to shake this country again. If you think 9/11 been bad, beloved, just wait. Just wait. God is getting ready to shake this country again. Now, preacher, how you know that? But tell me the date that he's going to do it. Well, I don't know the date. I don't know the circumstances. But the word of God through the gift of the Holy Spirit through revelations tells me that God is getting ready to shake America again. And they're going to shake America because of your killing, your arrogancy, your lack of faith. God is getting ready to do something in this country have never seen before.
Come on, preacher.
Oh, are you a soothsayer? Are you a prophet, preacher? No, I'm not a soothsayer. No, I'm not a prophet. I'm just telling you what the God is telling me to tell you. God is getting ready to shake America again. He's tired of this mess. He gives us a warning. Just a month and a half ago, and the church still remains empty. Still remains unfaithful. Now that God knows that we don't take his warning serious enough. Don't be surprised, beloved, when God shakes this country again. And let me tell you, beloved, I'm not trying to scare you, but God particularly going to shake Washington. God is going to shake Washington again. I want to tell you, my pastor, if you listen to our pastor, he's been saying the same thing for 3 years about God's warning. I'm not saying anything different than he has preached. I'm not saying anything different than the word of God. God is getting ready to shake this place. That's right. Because we refuse to adhere to his warnings. We refuse. You see the church nearly empty. That's why God laid it on my heart to call 10 million black men back to church. As I told that young man standing in the cable line yesterday, I cannot help you unless I know what you're suffering from. And I cannot pray for you. Can I help you with a job if you're outside of the church? Come to church. Somebody may have a job for you. Come to church and accept the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior. Before God decides to shake this place. So you need to move aside because they're coming. And when God shakes this place, beloved, when God shakes this place, just like Saul, you're going to know that you've been shaken. The doors of the church is open. The doors of the church is open. If there's one who have heed to the word of God and ready to accept the Lord Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, I would urge you to come and accept the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. For God is getting ready to shake this place. And you don't want to be on the outside of the church. If God is going to shake this place, you want to be in the house, safe and secure. So let the wind come and let the storm come. God will keep you anchored in his word. And he will save you. Just like he will save that young good-looking boy right there who should stay away from my daughter. God is good. And he will never forsake you. No, not even to the ends of time. Sunday school is about to start.
As soon as I accept this man in, you can give the benediction.
Now we will give the benediction.
Oh, yeah.
I did.
After this man.
Okay.
New members coming in.
Okay. New members coming in.
hear from the deacon?
Yes, Reverend Davis, we have coming before us Brother Kerry Price, based on his Christian experience, requesting membership to Mount Zion Baptist Church.
Fine, you know here at Mount Zion, we don't vote on it, so give him a hand. Kerry has been here for a long time, but he finally made up his mind to become part of our family. He's a prayer meeting every Wednesday night. He's a good servant here. Now, the only thing we require of you, you have to go through the new membership classes to the Sunday school, be a prayer with Sister Rogers. She's going to teach you the things you need to know. And you can start this morning when you come in, get that out of the way if you have time. But it's good to have you, Brother Kerry. And once you've completed the new membership class, we give you a right hand of fellowship. But you remember now, that's just a main formality. But once you accept Christ as your Savior, you already become part of His church. You just join our family to help us serve the Lord. Can we say amen?
Amen. If you will stand there, we will have the benediction. Let us pray. Our Father, our God, we thank you, O Lord. Thank you for the soul that you have sent. Oh, gracious God, hallelujah. The Bible says that the angels dance in heaven when one soul come to Christ Jesus. Oh, Lord, we're shouting here. And we thank you, oh, Lord. In your precious, holy, adorable, wonderful, gracious name, let us all say together, amen.